On Esther chapter 5, verses 1, please. NIV. Shall we all stand together and let's read together? It's amazing scripture. Let's be all of it. Let's read together. Galatians 5, 1. Ready? Go. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm, then, and do not let yourself be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. Let's move to verses number 13. Verse 13. You, ready, go. You, my brothers, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the sinful nature. Rather, serve one another in love. Amen. You may be seated. Then go to verse 14. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. And he says, stand firm, then. And do not let yourself, number one, to be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. This morning, I'm speaking to you, freedom in Christ. Say freedom. Freedom. And freedom in Christ. Say freedom. Say I am free. Say I have my freedom. Spiritual freedom. Mental freedom. Emotional freedom. Jesus Christ has called me into freedom. So nothing can break me down. Freedom. Freedom is a right to act, speak, or think as one world without hindrances. So God created you and I. Jesus Christ called you and I. And he gave them the gift of freedom. Freedom is a gift. Say, freedom is a gift. And every human being needs to enjoy the gift of freedom. And if you go back to the team of the year, say, God can do far more than what you can do or think according to the power that is working in us. So one of the greatest things God can do far more than anything in your life is freedom. It will give you freedom. God can do that one far more than what you can think is freedom. And it's a gift. The right. Freedom is your right. Freedom is a gift from the living God. God wants every born again believer to enjoy this gift of freedom. We are all, because this freedom is very, very important and it's very, very crucial, and it is the gift from the living God. Look, go through the scripture, you can go through the scripture or the history of this world, how so many people fought the great battle, struggle, fight for the freedom. At the personal level and also community level. Because the most important thing, money, is freedom. Freedom in every area of your life and our lives. That you have freedom to the point that you have the asset to do anything without any restraint, without any difficulty. Freedom of speech, freedom of exercise your right, freedom to move out, freedom to move in, freedom to do anything. I pray for you, but from now to the end of the year, you will have freedom to do whatever you want to do, except sin. Say, except sin. Freedom to choose, and freedom to reject. But as I'm talking to you right now, so many of us doesn't have this gift of freedom. Doesn't have this gift of freedom. Emotional freedom, mental freedom, physical freedom, freedom to move out, freedom to move in, freedom to speak. Even though we are born again believers, even in your own house, your husband and your wife, one of them doesn't have freedom to express his view and opinion. I pray that this morning, by the end of this message, Your eyes will be open and you possess this right.
This right?
Freedom. It's very, very important. We need that. Give me the scripture. Let me take the scripture out of the place. Give me verse 1. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Christ has set you and I free. And he said, stand firm then, and do not let yourself, number one, be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. Christ died for you and I. He purchased us with a price. And then the reason why he came and died for you and I is to give them the precious gift of freedom. And what the Bible is telling us is, verse number 30 said, this freedom doesn't give them the license to sin. No. It doesn't give them the license to sin. It said, therefore, we shouldn't allow, number one enemy is myself, yourself, to burden us with the yoke of slavery. When somebody is in slavery, when the yoke is upon one, that person doesn't have any freedom to do whatever he wants to do. So this is what I'm talking about, freedom in Christ. But you have three kinds of freedom. Number one, physiological freedom or mental freedom. Mental freedom. That physiologically, mentally, you have sound mind. There's no oppression and depression upon somebody. As a matter of fact, we can dress very nice, put on beautiful suit like myself, but mentally, you don't have freedom. There are so many things oppressing and depressing your life. I pray by the end of this message, the power of God will set you free from any mental oppression. So one of the areas that Christ wants his people to have freedom is your mental. Mental. You have sound mind. Number two, ethical or moral freedom. Your life. Lead good life, good behavior. The third one is political or social freedom. I'm not talking about that. That's the problem facing the whole world. So remember, the book of Acts 1, when Jesus Christ came, he died and resurrected 40 days spending with the disciples, and he said, go and wait for me, and then you shall receive the gift. Immediately the disciples said, it's time for you to give back the kingdom, right? So they thought that Jesus Christ is coming to give them the political world, freedom. Because that time they were under the oppression of the Roman world, empire. So they thought that Jesus' mission was to come as a presidential leader. No, he didn't come like that. You can, believer can have freedom mentally. So many areas. But the political, if the leader is not a Christian, we'll fight. But this morning, I'm talking about Christ's freedom. Freedom in Christ. As well as your personal life, your mental faculty, your heart, spiritually, you have freedom. No nothing, no evil can rule over your life. Without freedom, a nation without freedom can never be productive. A man without freedom, it is the freedom and liberty that brings productivity. Spiritual productivity, physical productivity, financial productivity. That's what sometimes when we come on again, Peter said, come, let us set you free from this, you know, crooked family, this crooked family. You know, sometimes you can be born again, but spiritually, you are not free.
There are certain yokes you find yourself, and that those yokes doesn't allow you to be fruitful, to be productive in your personal life. But this year, God is able to give you freedom far more than what you can think or imagine. That is something you and I need. Freedom to bear fruit, to bring your fruitfulness, physical fruitfulness, freedom to move out and to come in. Freedom. God is ready to give you an eye. If a child doesn't have freedom in the house, he can never grow anything. Hello? When we were growing up, we grew up with many people battling, fighting. As last week, I was sharing with you the experience. Everybody behaves according to how we see the world because of our grown up. So many things we experience in this life. So we live in the family house, the food was small. Grooves, no, you eat together in the same bowl. And if you're not strong enough, you can never enjoy the food. So anytime the food is ready, you can see if you are not strong enough, you begin to cry inside you, right? Always you cry inside you. And then you eat, but you begin to, you will never get weight, right? You become skinny. Why? Because you don't have freedom. There's no freedom in the house. So many people are here serving God, but they don't have freedom in their job place. They don't have freedom in their home, their own house. When they see their husband coming, they panic. When they see their wife coming, they panic. I break that yoke and I set you free in the name of Jesus. Whoever terrorizes you, putting fear in you, doesn't want you to enjoy your freedom. I pray by the blood of Jesus, receive your freedom. I love America so much. The freedom to do whatever. But where we are coming from, there's no freedom. There's no freedom. Even our parents, there's no freedom. That's why sometimes parents, let us learn something. That's why sometimes when these people go to college, they don't want to come home. They don't want to come home. But this life, I'm not saying I support the evil this. But this life, everybody needs their personal experience. Maybe some will get me wrong. But at the end, you understand me. Sometimes use your own life as an example. You know, sometimes that if you read the book of Ephesians, that says, children, obey your parents in the law. And if you read down, it says that parents don't provoke your children. We should learn those things together. Anything we do to provoke them, they are preaching for you. We parents, me, myself, yes. You know, I did something I regret. My daughter is here, I told her today. I did something, you know, sometimes because of the struggle of finances, and then you become so tough about so many things. Sometimes when you are calling them from the house, when they panic because we always attack them. Do you know that because they have learned this law, when you call them, they don't answer. They just appear like this. Because they know you are about to attack them, so they will defend themselves. How many of you have that experience? Am I talking to you? So they try to defend themselves. You know, I've been doing this to them and giving it to them. One day, I bought a car, Kenzia, you know, and then he went out, he went to work, and then he hit a certain wall he was parking. Instead for her to come and tell me that they have hit the car, because of my behavior, he was not wrong, he was right. Because the money was not there. And then he went downtown, look at that. When he told me that, I cried in the room, I didn't let him go. He went to downtown and find the body was shot, and then he did. And then he came home, he paid everything, came and told me that I was packing, and then that he worked at the downtown state house. I was packing, and then I hit, and then it's all no problem. That time I was already born again. But I look at her face, you know. Sometimes it's not about what is coming from the person, but check the inside. God has given me the gift. I also check inside, not what you are telling me. But I went to some place and found a cheap auto body shop and they said, oh, fear, why did you do that? You should have come to me. I will find a cheaper one over here. And I will do it. But I didn't blame him. It was because of my behavior and my character. He was afraid. And then immediately, the Holy Spirit took him to make a mistake. If I continue to behave like this towards him, something will happen to me. You will never tell me. And you go and tell other people. And it will destroy your life. All these things is about our behavior and our character. And he will know that maybe he might not have freedom to exercise them. When these children are exercising their opinion, they get mad. You get mad. Then you will get mad. You know, talking. I'm not quick. No, I'm making a mistake. Sometimes we shouldn't let the hatred and the poverty and the struggle and define us, and then we behave towards them. And at the time, when they are speaking their mind, we think that they don't respect. That's why they want to do movie about the African parents. Have you watched that? African parents. So we need to be free. Let them be free in the house. Amen. Freedom in the house. It's not the freedom of doing whatever they want to do. Train them, discipline them. Why they deserve the discipline? Show them. So children, don't take to me this other side. Are you getting the word? No, you don't have the right to do any evil. We will show you where you come from. You come from us. We have the power. We have the authority. But you also have the power and authority. We share ideas together. I've been here 20 years. I've been in two church. I know so many children that have been here, how their life has messed up. Men have taken advantage over them, destroyed their life. So I always think about that. The reason why I'm there is for your good. And why should I become my face, ugly face, and then driving them from the house? Do you know sometimes it is not that you are disciplining them, it's about your anger. You are going through stress and you are looking for somebody to blame. We are looking for somebody to blame. I'm going to have experience, I do that. Preaching to myself. He said, it is the freedom that Christ has called you to. Emotional freedom. Sometimes you know, when you don't have emotional freedom, you can never be productive. You can never enjoy. The wife doesn't have freedom in the house. They are all matrimonial house. The husband doesn't have, you know, some of the women doesn't talk that they are in charge. It's good for you to be in charge. But freedom is a gift that everybody needs to enjoy. That's why this American is not talking. It's love. When you work with somebody, you know, the company will know that person. But if you miss, whatever, do anything against you, you can see the person in the court. You can never take anybody's right into granted. Anything, confrontation, do evil. We need to check all these tendencies in this life. It will help us to live in love, unity. Sometimes it's not that respect, it's a fear. Not that the person respects you, no, it's a fear. And don't let people live with you with fear. It's wrong. Don't live with you with respect. Love. Together. We should let our wife live with us with love. We should let our husband live with us with love. No fear. No fear. No. That's why we had secrets. All of us hide. Because if I tell you, I know you, what you will do. But you are the right person that should tell you what I have done. Rather hide. Because of what has happened. The Lord have mercy on us. The doors are also passed. I remember when I was growing up, my mom, he gave birth to me when he was young. He was not ready, he was doing his business and I entered. So, almost he blaming me. He can lock me inside the room and go out. What he will put for me is Avamo, I can be there 3 days. That's why I love Avamo and I should. And he will go because he was young. He was, you know, he go and then come back. So more things he will beat you. Beat you serious. Because it's not that you haven't done anything, but he said, because are you catching well? And then when I grown up, about 4 or 5 years, I went to Canada and said, he lives with the roommate. And I asked her, why am I going to sleep? He said, you sleep behind me at the bed. That's me. That time I was 48 years. So 48 years man, married person, will sleep behind the mother at the bed. And then in the night, anything can happen. You can sleep. When you sleep, so many things happen. Am I talking to you? Then I said, give me mattress, I will sleep out here. Here. And I told her that the time I was looking to sleep behind you, you didn't give me that chance. You didn't give me that chance. I'm not disgracing my mom, I'm telling the truth, experience. You didn't give, I was loved to be with you. You took me to my grandma. Nobody liked me. My grandma, it was even that grandma was not the grandma who gave birth to my mom. So Baba knew her. But tell what? When I'm sick, Otewa is sick. When I'm crying, Otewa is crying. He loved me to the point that I steal the money, he will never kiss me. He will never kiss me. He loved me, so I don't know anybody. I don't know any mother. But the only person I know is Otewa. Even he died. Anytime I go through trouble and cry and become so sad, the only person I remember after God, the only person I remember is Otewa. You know, we are something, when we cry, we mention our mothers and grandma. Mention they never cry. Lord and behold, the first time I went to Ghana, I saw her, he died in front of me. And I buried him. I remember they told me when he was about to die, one of the grandchild, because he was broke, he was poor. Everybody has rejected her. They said that, I know, my grandmother didn't have anybody. But I know when we die, God will bring angel to come and bring back. And then I went there with Osomame. We saw her, we greeted her. I spent 6 weeks in Ghana. My 4th week, he died. He died. And then I give the money, I bury him. I was satisfied. So the reason why I have been thinking about talking about this, but I don't know this why this message is telling me to that. That we should let our children, family, have freedom. Not freedom to sin. Not freedom to do evil. But the freedom to live as a family. Live as a family. Sometimes you see somebody in your faith. Even that time, he doesn't have anything to, but because of the previous experience, lovely. Pastor Ahi says, Daniel says something last Friday. He said that there's 3 stages in life. That the first time stage is when you yourself in your case, when you are taking care of your case. And then other stages will be when the case also are taking care of you. The time you were taking care of them, you tell them that sleep, they will sleep. Eat this, they will eat without question. The time will come, you be the child, they will be the mother and the father. So it is a freedom. So God wants us to enjoy freedom. Muslim, mentally, every area of our life, the Lord wants us to enjoy freedom. It doesn't mean we should pamper them. We should pamper each other. Tell them the truth. Show them the danger. What we can tell them. What can destroy their life. But don't let them afraid of you with fear.
to let them love us.
What is true freedom to Jesus?
Give me the true freedom to Jesus. Please, pray for me. What is true freedom to Jesus Christ? I've been talking about the political freedoms, the theological freedom, and then ethical freedom. What is the true freedom of Jesus Christ? He said that it's freedom from anything that will hinder us from fully understanding your identity in Christ. Jesus' freedom is anything that will hinder you and I of not fully understanding our identity in Him. God wants us to understand ourselves, the identity He has given us. Anything that does it has become hindrances to your life and my life. Not understanding your identity in Christ, the power you have in Christ, the authority you have in Christ. Allah is not freedom to Christ. Christ wants you and I to understand our identity in Him. That He has given you the power and the authority over the devil. If you know from anything that will hinder us from fully understanding our identity in Christ, we have been bought and paid for by Christ. So we belong to Christ Himself. True freedom in Christ, separate life and separate fight. We were enslaved. We were in danger. We were in bondage. He came and paid the price, sacrifice for your freedom. As a matter of fact, the victim of Jesus Christ died, sacrificed, paid the price for us in freedom. Without paying the price, there will be no freedom. So Christ wants you and I that are serving Him, understand your identity in Him, the power you have in Him. So whosoever is taking authority over your identity is not right. It's not right. And the word that God says about freedom, say we should it. Take that freedom to sin. Yes, we need those things. Look at Jesus Christ's life, Luke chapter 4. Said that, and then he said that after baptizing, went to the wilderness, and then he was, tempted by the devil for 40 days. After he came to the center, he said, hey, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. And He has anointed me to set the captive world free. I pray this year, the power of God will set you free. Financial, the power of God will set you free. Emotion, the power of God will set you free. In every area, freedom is coming to you. Freedom is coming to you. Freedom is coming to you. Every area you are struggling, the power of God is coming to you. Freedom is coming to you. To set the captive free. So many of us, we have been in captivity for a long time. Physically, people see us. But spiritually, mentally, we are in captivity. God's power, if you know your identity in Christ, His power is coming to you so that you will set yourself free. But let's go to the scripture, give you a few points, then get away from your house. Yeah, see that? It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. The first part, the scripture says, therefore stand firm. Then, and do not let yourself be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. Watch. He said that stand firm. Yes, we fight for freedom. Ghana fight for freedom for independence. Nigeria fight for freedom for independence. America fight for freedom for independence. And after you receive the independence, you have the obligation. You have some work to do to maintain your freedom. After you become born again, nothing is automatic. After you become born again, you have the obligation to maintain your freedom. So number one point, God is telling us, yes, you are free. It is the freedom that Christ has called us to.
You have the freedom to do anything. But God, the word is stand firm. Say stand firm. Stand firm in your freedom. It is your right to stand by yourself. Stand firm. Proverbs 23:23 says, stand firm by the truth and stand up. Stand for the truth. Stand for the truth for the scripture. Stand for the truth. We need to stand for the truth. Stand firm. And then 1 Corinthians 15:53 said that, my brothers and my sisters, stand firm. Do not be shaken. And you know that your labors in the Lord will never be in vain. And keep on doing the work of the living God. And stand firm. One of the areas that you can never enjoy your freedom is, it's up to you to stand. What will make you stand? One of the things that will make you stand is prayer. So many of you, prayer is not part of us. How can you stand? Because this devil we are fighting, he always wants to push us back into slavery. When God delivered the children of Israel from captivity, as they were going, they were not reaching the promised land, the enemy was chasing after them. Church, the reason why some of you don't understand us, why we preach about demon, we talk about, yeah, that demon that you left him is still chasing after you. So if you don't pray and bind him, he will chase after you. Do you know that nothing is free? Last one, they were saying about the pastor who made the illustration that using the lamb as example, he purchased the lamb, and then even he purchased the lamb from somebody paid, and somebody also were fighting for that lamb. It took him to bring his soldier. Okay? What freedom God has given you, somebody doesn't want you to enjoy that freedom. So he will do everything possible to push you back into slavery. Say, I will never go back to slavery. The slavery of poverty, no, I will never go back. It's not going to stand firm. I said, don't let anything move you. Enemy is enemy. We shouldn't let anything move us from the freedom that Christ has called us into. Some of us, we haven't been in slavery before. Some of you were born into your daddy's home. You were daddy's son, daddy's daughter. Your daddy and your mom have so many caretakers in your house that the caretaker, home, you call me. Some of the trouble you are going through is because of the maid your daddy hired to take care of you. You were witches. But when they were mistreating her, she also spiritually mistreated you. You know the reason you dream and you always see that maid that your mom used to see. There's something beautiful about it. Come on. Don't let anything. So if you have been in slavery before and you have freedom, you know you want the power of freedom. You will never take the freedom to granted. Freedom to breathe. Freedom to do anything, to eat any food. You know, the men can tell you as you come in 40, 50, you go to, when you are young, you have freedom to eat and drink anything. You can eat anything. But now, you don't have freedom to eat anything. And now, I don't have freedom to eat anything. I love food more than anything. The one I don't have right to eat is the one I long to eat. I want to program yesterday morning with Pastor James. I see this drink, they have what we should take, but I see my eyes is becoming this. So let me take what I drink. If something is bothering your freedom, you know how freedom is. I drink. I took another one. I drink. Because there's something over here. Say, take. I drink. And all those food I was eating, they have won me not to eat. I don't have freedom to eat. If you read the book of Isaiah, someone said that there's something error in the world. that God has blessed you everything, all kinds of food, all kinds of things, but they don't give you the right to eat some. He was the meal. Sitting here, hello? Do you agree with me? You know, so this time, when I see the breakfruit, my eye becomes this. But when I was young, I didn't like it. But now they have warned me, the enemy is pushing me. So I need to stand firm. I need to stand firm. My brother, you also stand firm. We can't finish our hands to let you. When God open another door, will continue. But look at the one, he said that, go back to him, he said that, it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm, then, and do not let yourself be burdened. One of the enemy to your freedom is not the devil, but myself. You know the testimony I'm sharing with you? My greatest enemy is not the demon for my family. My greatest enemy is myself. My last, you see? Those things, right? Yeah. The last of the flesh. The eye or whatever, and then the pride. So many of us, God has granted that freedom. But you pray against the devil money, it is not him, it is yourself. It is myself that takes me back to the bondage of slavery. To the bondage of slavery. Let's read last scripture and then we're done. Galatians 2, 4 and 5. Galatians 2, 4 and 5. This matter arose because some false brothers had inflated our ranks to spy on the freedom we have in Christ Jesus and to make us what? Slaves. We did not give in to them for a moment, so that the truth of the gospel might remain with us. So many things that become the enemy to my freedom, your freedom. The one is myself. Say myself. The last in me, my eyes. What pushed me to last the woman? My own eyes. Pride of life. The pride in me, not the devil in me. Lead me. Take away my freedom. And then another one is false believers. The false believers. If you joke the false believers, because over there, Paul was talking to as he started the church, he said the gospel to the people, and then the false teachers came in. And they were fighting with the circumcision and non-circumcision. Don't let anybody become a false believer and take you out from your freedom. Your freedom is your inheritance. And in the freedom that Christ has called us, if we are able to maintain our freedom, devil has no chance in our lives. Who is that devil? We always give the devil a chance. But when our eyes open, I stand against the devil and maintain our freedom. Sister, you will enjoy your life. Don't let anybody push you to lose the freedom that God has given you. False belief in business, poverty. Sometimes you start your business, you start so many things, you allow false brothers to come in and destroy what you are getting. Never. Bad communication. Bad friendship. Enter. And as you enjoy your life, so beautiful and so bright, somebody come with bad advice, destroy your life. Your freedoms are your inheritance. Maintain your freedom. A nation with a freedom attitude, always establish, always produce much, Enjoy their life. Maintain the freedom in your house. Don't let devil enter into your house and take away the freedom that you are enjoying in your children. Bringing sickness, bringing problem, bringing so many things in that family. Came against them. Because Christ has called you to freedom. Advise your husband. The step they are taking, that will take the family back to slavery. War! War there is ready. We don't want the devil to come and take advantage of us. The steps you are taking will take us back to slavery. Every area. When a man enjoys peace, freedom, it shows in every area of their life. Freedom is your gift. Freedom is your inheritance. Preserve the freedom. Preserve the freedom that Christ has given you. Have a share. God bless you. God bless you. Preserve the freedom. Spiritually, you will be there. From captivity, preserve that freedom. With prayer. Absolutely.